There was something about surrealism with its emphasis on the dream and on fantasy and on the unconscious and of reshaping society that gave any number of women artists this sense of freedom and possibility. There were a number of female artists who worked within surrealist circles and with surrealist ideas and with concepts. And today I'm going to show you just a few of my favorites of those. So Claude Cahun was a French artist who moved to Paris in the early 1920s, was involved both with experimental theater companies and an outspoken member of the Parisian lesbian community between the two world wars. So here, we're looking at this tiny, jewel-like, black and white, photographic self-portrait. You see Cahun's face reflected, or is it trapped, in the glass surface of a bell jar, which is an everyday object typically used for protecting delicate things. Another of my favorites in the collection is Meret Oppenheim's carefully fur-covered teacup, saucer, and spoon. With this simple gesture of lining these items, normally associated with genteel domesticity, with gazelle fur. According to legend, this object was inspired by a conversation that she had with the artists Dora Maar and Pablo Picasso. At the time, she was wearing a fur-covered bracelet that she had designed, and Picasso looked at that and said, "Oh, you can cover anything with fur these days," to which Meret Oppenheim replied, "Even this cup, saucer, and spoon." Oppenheim transforms the everyday into something that is at once seductive, invites us to touch it, and repulsive, because the moment you begin to think of this on your breakfast table in the morning and drinking out of that, things rapidly become very strange. So another work in the collection by a woman artist associated with surrealism is Frida Kahlo's self-portrait with cropped hair. This is a characteristic work by Kahlo in the sense that it is autobiographical and it is a self-portrait, but it is unusual in the way that she is depicting herself. It is, I think, best described as the aftermath of a haircut. This is painted in 1940, immediately following Kahlo's divorce from her husband, Diego Rivera, and in fact, the oversized gray suit she wears and the crimson-red shirt are attributes of Rivera. And here you see her donning them, right, in what is both perhaps an act of mourning, but also one of self-assertion and of autonomy and of setting out on her own. Kahlo is someone who always resisted the label surrealism. She didn't like to be categorized that way, although she appreciated the French surrealist poet and surrealism's leaders, André Breton's great enthusiasm for her work, which he described, I think, as akin to a ribbon wrapped around a bomb. And I think that gets at the peculiar combination of both delicacy of realization here and the implicit violence of this act of cutting your hair completely off, as evidenced by all these writhing tendrils scattered across the floor and even a little braid draped over here. So another work that I could spend hours looking at is Remedios Varo's meticulously painted dreamscape, The Magician or the Juggler. And it's really worth getting in close to the figure of the magician here, both to see how she's rendered this fantastical outfit of his that seems to sparkle and glow with light, and to get a close look at the facial features that are in the shape of a pentagram, a five-sided shape that is a sign of enlightenment, and that in fact in this picture is made of mother of pearl inlaid into the surface of this painting, and that for Varo was also a material that symbolized enlightenment. In the early 1940s, she fled Europe, fascism, the war, and settled in Mexico City. And there she became part of a vibrant group of emigre exiled artists and intellectuals. Varo, in fact, along with Frida Kahlo and her great friend Leonora Carrington, are the three great women artists associated with Mexican Surrealism. And because Varo painted relatively few works, and there are virtually none in public collections in the United States, she is the furthest thing from a household name here in this country, whereas in Mexico, she's very well known. In traditional art histories, you might read a lot about the way that the male surrealists celebrated women as muses, right, as their inspiration, as passive objects. And I think what is important to remember is that women played just as much of an important role as active makers, as creative forces, as poets or playwrights or painters or collagists. Here at the museum and elsewhere, we all want to do everything that we can to make that aspect of women's involvement with surrealism more widely known.